gather to worship on this day. This is an extraordinary day. We are still waiting the arrival of our organist, Ann Hellinger, but until she comes, our pianist is Deborah Chung, and we're so happy to have her. She was sitting in the back, and I said, Deborah, could you play our songs this morning? And she came and is ready to lead us, and we appreciate that very, very much. We are still in the aura of the service that was held here yesterday for Sharon's husband, Greg. And we gave honor to God for his life, thanking God for his life, and knowing how God receives him home. In our service this morning, we will hear this wonderful story of the rich man and Lazarus. You know this story, but we'll tell it again today because a good story is always worth retelling, right?
Yes.
And we'll hear how it is that Lazarus winds up, through no good reason that I can tell, in the bosom of Abraham, which would seem to indicate to me that if Lazarus gets there for no good reason, well, then we should all get there. As long as we don't mess up the path, yeah? As long as we get there. Oh, and speaking of messing up the path, you may have noticed that there's a rim of cars around the edge of our parking lot. That is the transportation of about 50 good folk who are in the business of cleaning up the trails that go through the Patapsco State Park. We greeted them this morning and thanked them for their work and sent them on their way. I was overdressed. I could not help. It's a good day. May the Lord's blessing be with us. Greet now Phyllis Martin, who informs us of the announcements of the day.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Never matters how many people are here, I always love seeing the smiling faces. And everybody who's here right now is my favorite. Of course, I'm going to say that again next week. But, you know. As far as announcements goes, we would like to remind you that the Bible study is getting started in October on prayer and the book by Max Lucado, Before, Amen. These are available back in the worship hall for $10, and we would love to have you sign up and join our study that will begin not this week, but next week on October the 5th. This Wednesday at 7 o'clock, there is a church council meeting. That'll start at 7 o'clock, but at 6:15, we will be meeting in the chapel for prayer prior to the meeting. Also, I'd like to mention that there's a worship and music committee meeting, not this week, but next, and it'll be on Tuesday, October the 4th, because we're starting the Bible studies on Wednesday. The worship and music committee will meet on Tuesday, October the 4th. We've got a few things coming up. Next Sunday, October the 2nd, is our service of Holy Communion, and this one is special. It is the World Communion Sunday. So it's an international event, and we are looking for anyone in the congregation who may be a linguist, someone who may speak another language that might be able to give us a more international flair to the service that we would like to provide. So if you are one of those or you know someone who can assist us with that, that would be appreciated. Thank you. We extend our welcome to those of us who are online and joining us through our service through this virtual way. It's always a pleasure to be able to present this to you. It is our privilege to be able to put this together for you. And we invite you to join us on Sunday mornings at 10:15, and please bring family or friends, or both. And we would love to see you, because no one knows what can happen when we all gather together in God's love. So at this time, let us pass the peace amongst each other. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Share that peace with those around us and those online. Don't forget the pastor hiding up here behind the pulpit. This is the day that the Lord hath made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice, let us rejoice, and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made.
This is the first Sunday in the season of autumn. Or is it the season of fall? Which are you? Are you an autumn person? Which seems to be the British rendition of the season. Or are you a fall person? That is very much attuned to the falling leaves because you know you're going to have to rake them. Which is it for you? It's the only season with two names. Isn't that interesting? Greeted by us who are tired of the heat and looking forward to the beauty of the fall season, but also as a sign of the ongoingness of God's love. This continual turning over of seasons means that the plan is still working. We may do what we do in opposition to nature's wanting to keep on working, but nature keeps turning over. Let us pray. As the season of autumn opens before us, O Lord, may we see in it the continual unfolding of your goodness and mercy. You are with us in the processes of nature, showing us your beauty in the wonder you place before us, in the changing, growing, and life-flourishing power of trees and plants around us. Call us likewise to be ever-growing in our faithfulness to you, fully living out our lives as your creatures. Amen. We join now into a hymn that's found in our Faith We Sing book called Let All Things Now Living, a song of thanksgiving to God the Creator triumphantly raised. Let's stand and sing together.
Please join me in our call to worship. Those who dwell in the secret place of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say, my refuge and my fortress, my God, in you I trust.
We come seeking that secret place, abiding close to the Lord. God's faithfulness is our shield and protection, inviting us to the freedom of your fear.
God is our refuge. We hear the words of promise upholding us. For God will give angels charge of you to guard you in all your ways. Praise be to God, who answers our calls and fills our lives with hope and the promise of salvation. And now we have our hymn, It Is Well With My Soul.
And we're happy that you are here. Give you a moment, catch your breath, and we will sing, okay. It Is Well With My Soul. I think it's 377, am I right?
Yes, 377.
I'm
Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Let's now take a few moments for silent prayer and confession. Join me now in our unison prayer of confession. Righteous and merciful God, you have called us to a life of service in honor of your name and to the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ. You would equip us to fight the good fight of faith, yet we confess that too often we are deaf to your call. And let the ways of the world lead us. Our faithfulness falls to dust and ashes. Yet you still love us and keep calling us to your side and blessing us with your mercy and love. Forgive us, O Lord, and open again our hearts to your vision of life, your instructions for how to live in community with others, and your hope for a world at peace with itself and filled with the beauty for which you created us. Amen. And the Lord offers these words of forgiveness. The Lord God is merciful and gracious, endlessly patient, loving, and true, showing mercy to thousands, forgiving transgressions, and granting pardon. Now let us join the video, Prayer Inspirations.
But that we can always be deepening our prayer life. After all, the object of our prayer is for us to come close to God. And that is an astounding, astounding goal to have. So it is incumbent upon us to be always working in that regard. Not to say that even the most feeble prayer lifted to the Lord is not an adequate prayer, but for our prayer life to lift ourselves ever closer to God takes what Timothy, the letter to Timothy, calls fighting the good fight of faith, right? Lord, I want to draw closer to you. I share this video with you with some words concerning prayer from spiritual leaders of the past in hope that it may lead us forward in our prayer life in the present. time we do this, we're going to have a voiceover, right? So that we can read out those words. You may remember the ones, from, I think, from Martin Luther, pray to God and let him worry. And the final words from Jeremiah. That is God's wish to hear our prayers. As was explained to me by one of my mentors in seminary, he would say to me, "Dave, the Lord is waiting for your prayers. He's got his ear bent in your direction. All you have to do is mention a word and he calls over all the angels. Hey, listen up. Dave is praying." To say to us all, God wants to hear our prayers. And shall we share our prayers with the Lord this morning, our joys and our concerns? As I mentioned last week, one of the emotions of prayer is that of mourning. We talked about how Jeremiah, the prophet, mourned over the condition of his people. And as a reflection of that, God mourns over our plight, over our sorrows. Jesus said, "Blessed are they who mourn." Matter of fact, Eloise reminded me of that this week, because she called me up to say, "Hey, what about that blessed are those who mourn?" Because it's in the upper room for today, on the day that we are mourning the loss of Queen Elizabeth II. And let me ask you, as we begin our prayers, for whom or for what do we mourn today? In your hearts, where is there mourning today? Sir? Yeah.
I seem to be mourning a lot about those youth in the vicinity that have lost their lives to violence. I just feel like, you know, they're starting their lives and this violence takes over and they're gone.
We mourn for particularly the young people whose lives lost to violence. We certainly mourn for the people of Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, Bermuda, Nova Scotia, whose lives have been torn upside down by the floods of Hurricane Fiona, and for the impending danger that lies in the path of the next hurricane through the Gulf and into Florida. Others for whom we would mourn. Let us know that they who mourn will be comforted. Amen. Joe. Okay.
May I say, Joel has a brother, and he's living at a home.
He's been in a nursing home since December.
Joel is mourning for the brother, Richard, who is not with us, and his family's here, and he's somewhere else, and it's just as sad.
We mourn with Joel and Shirley for Joel's brother,
Richard.
Let the Lord comfort him and bring him strength and his family.
Yes.
We turn. I'm sorry. Yes, Sharon?
Yeah, Pastor. I want to thank everyone that was involved yesterday for my husband's memorial. It was beautiful service to thank you. Thank you for all that is involved because it was.
And we give thanks for those who mourned with us yesterday and felt the comfort of the Lord in the gathering that was there. Wants to make sure that her thanks is to all those who made that yesterday possible. Okay. We have a wonderful kitchen crew to make sure that folks are well fed. Hospitality means a lot. And those who look after the sanctuary here, that all is in good order. Let's see, we look to Michelle now. We appreciate Susan for accumulating the, gathering the notes of those for whom we would pray. And Michelle will share that with us now.
We have two members that are traveling today. That's Sandy and Bobby. They're taking their vacation to the beach. And so we pray for traveling mercies for them. And pray that they have a wonderful time of rest and relaxation. On the list here is a friend of Dan Kirshner, Martin Boyer, who had some leg pain. There's a concern for Sandy's friend Ronnie McCauley. He stopped radiation due to blood pressure and dehydration. All of our chemo and radiation group. There's a note here about a man named Dave Ferraro. I got a message from Donna Belcher. She was Stuart Powers' companion, and she's in Pennsylvania. She had a stay at the hospital and now is in the rehabilitation center. So she asked for us to pray for her. Mary Crosney has tested positive for COVID. She's there in Encore. Tim O'Hara, who is Linda O'Hara's husband, is still suffering with symptoms of his COVID. They had a trip a couple weeks ago and they came back with COVID. And a man named Joel Rose needs a kidney transplant. Any other concerns for the day?
Yeah.
Maybe. I had a chance to speak with Harry Wilhelm briefly yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
He turned 95.
Oh, wow.
And I told him we rejoice with him, and Amen. He just should Amen. Keep on going.
That's right. He's Harry Wilhelm at 95.
Yeah, he's a little lonely because his the lady friend who helps him with transportation is out of the country.
Oh.
Her family, from where she came from.
Brazil.
Her family is having some health problems. And so she will be back for a couple of months. He says, I'm going to be lost. I'm looking at grandchildren, which one can get my dinners for me next week.
Let's keep Harry in our prayers. We'll take you some of our soup. We're sharing it. Yeah, I think that would be good. Keep Harry Wilhelm in our prayers. Others? For whom we would look to the Lord.
We have a praise.
That praise.
My husband's sister is 3 years younger, and she's getting to feel a little uncomfortable traveling long distances.
Uh-huh.
But she's with friends to see, and they're not far from us.
Uh-huh.
So she's going to be coming to us from Tuesday night to Thursday morning.
Oh.
And so he hasn't seen his sister for well over a year.
Oh.
And in that interval, he's only spoken with her on the phone maybe three or four times.
Well, that'll be quite something. What's her name?
We never know when it will be her last trip.
Yeah. What's her name?
Her name is Carol O'Donohue.
Carol.
And she's living upstate New York.
Yeah. So it'll be great to see your sister.
Yep.
And we pray for that reunion
Amen.
And for your time together. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Susan?
Just prayers for the nation as a whole, for all the things that have happened around the world.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also prayers for people that have physical disabilities and for mental disabilities.
Yeah. Yeah. Prayer for our world and all the situations. And prayers for persons with disabilities, particularly mental disabilities, that are so hard to deal with. Let's continue to keep in our prayers Larry Rockenbaugh as he seeks to recover and heal and grow stronger after his hip surgery. We continue to remember Andy Anderson. Andy has returned to his home apartment at Charlestown, but continues in therapy for his recent back surgery as well. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Almighty, most merciful, most wonderful, unending loving God, we give you our thanks and praise. Lord, you know we just expect you to be there. You are our divine assumption. Because our assumption, Lord, is whenever it is we choose to turn to you in prayer, you are there to hear our prayers and to take us into your heart and to understand us and receive us and be responsive to us. We assume that. Lord, do you assume that we are always ready to receive your answer to our prayers? To receive your guidance in our prayers, to take your correction in our lives,
to receive your guidance and to hear your word. Help us. Help us. Help us. We thank you, Lord, for the mercies that you provide for us. We thank you, Lord, for the folks of this faith community, this congregation called Trinity, for that which we are able to do for each other and for all others, for the efforts that we make in hospitality and for the efforts that we make in outreach to others in need. We give you thanks and pray that you not only sustain us in that work, but increase us in that work. We look to you, Lord, for those whom we have named, persons seeking healing, persons recovering from procedures. Lord, we remember Glova, who has returned home from her procedure, and pray that healing and strength goes well with her, as well as with Andy and Larry and others. Be with Mary, Lord. Be with Mary at this time of recovering from COVID. Keep her strong. Make her well. We look to you for those we've named. We know, Lord, that you are the God of community, and we ask you to bless this community. We thank you for those laborers who went out this morning in order to clean the trails, make the way good for folks who would enjoy a walk, a ride, or run through the woods. And we thank you for them. We thank you, Lord, that we can be a part of that, and you show us other ways that we might best serve this community. We thank you, Lord, you're the God of families, and pray for the blessing that you shed upon us as our families join together. We pray, O Lord, for this reunion of Preston and Carol, that it may be well and that visit be enriched by your love. We look to you for those who struggle in this world, those who struggle with disabilities, particularly, Lord, those mental disabilities that cloud the mind, befuddle judgment, and make it just hard to get a good grasp on life. And we pray you be with those folks and provide help, succor, and the balm, that it may be well for them. We pray for our world, Lord, just full of turmoil and strife, but also full of good people that seek to help, that rush to help, and that send help, that all may be well. Nourish that, Lord, enrich that, provide global hospitality. We look to you, and we give you our praise, we give you our thanks, and pray that you might always fulfill our assumptions with your unending love, and that, Lord, you may equip us with an unending love for you, a hunger for your presence, and a deep, deep desire to be close to you. We pray these prayers in Jesus' name, and as he taught us, we will say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In further efforts to help us all grow in our prayer life, we're offering this Bible study on prayer. You know, we're using this little book that little book by Max Licato for our four sessions on prayer, as he will help us to deepen our prayer life. Now, it's not our goal that we'll all understand what Max has to say, although he has some interesting things to say. Our goal is that we come together and help one another grow richer in our prayer life. I invite you to be a part of that study. Pick up a book today and come and let's join together. Hear now the reading of the scriptures for this day. But first, this video.
Grace thy faithfulness, O God.
to, oh, I know you listen carefully all the time, but let me ask you to do this. In the course of the Timothy reading, you're going to hear something about fighting the good fight of faith, right? Hold on to that phrase, and then as the gospel is read from St. Luke, ask yourself, how does that phrase, fight the good fight of faith, apply to this parable of Jesus?
Our scripture reading, 1 Timothy chapter 6. But as for you, men of God, shun all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, with which he will bring about at the right time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. It is he alone who has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen.
Amen.
If you would please stand for our gospel reading from the book of Luke, chapter 16. Beginning in verse 19. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out,
Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames.
But Abraham said, Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us. And he said,
And Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment.
Abraham replied, They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them. And he said,
No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent.
And Abraham said to him, If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Well, we thank once again our outstanding dramatic team of Phyllis and Jeremiah. Jeremiah, of course, hope you notice his purple shirt, because he's clothed in purple.
Yes, the 60s version of purple.
Just the best. Thrift shop has to offer. But he's residing separated from Abraham, who is much on high. However, nevertheless, still being addressed by Abraham as child. You notice that? Suffering in torment, as it were, but still father and child. It's an interesting thing. But finally, is it not a very sad parable? Because as it ends, the rich man, we'll get back to him and his pleading in a moment, but the rich man is saying, why don't you send somebody back from the dead? Who's telling this story? Who's telling this story? Jesus is telling this story. Jesus is at least aware that he is the one who will come back from the dead to warn others. But Abraham in the story is speaking for who? God? For whom? Says, no, even if somebody comes back from the dead, they will not heed the warning. Is he talking about us? We're the ones who know Jesus is coming back from the dead. And he has a warning for us, does he not? Yeah. And the warning is, what? You can go to hell, right? There's torment. And you got to do something about that. So we got to look at what it is we're supposed to do about that, right? I'm just saying. Otherwise, it's a very sad parable. Now, what I want to ask is connecting that fight the good fight of faith with this story of the rich man and Lazarus. By the way, don't you think it's really neat that the poor guy has a name and the rich man doesn't? Why do you think that might be? You think maybe Jesus didn't know his name? Jesus knew practically everything, right? I mean, he knew Philip before he even met him. What? Yeah, but he didn't use it because I think for Jesus, the rich man represents a certain category of people, right? The upper 5% who own 95% of the wealth, yeah? He represents them, right? And he wants to say a word to them. Not only to them, but to the whole setup of things as they exist. So there is this rich man. Notice also that most of the verbs setting this thing up are verbs of continuity. It said the rich man used to always wear rich clothes, dress opulently, and ate extravagantly. Or is it the opposite? I think he dressed extravagantly and ate opulently. Right? He did that all the time. And then there was this poor man named Lazarus. You know what Lazarus means? God help us. In a neat name, God help us. First clue, right? If God helps, then what? We better help too. Yeah, that's the first clue. And it said that he got plunked down there. It said he squatted, but the word means more like he got plunked down there. Some of his friends put him there so that the rich man could help him. But apparently never did. And then it said, what? Dogs would come and used to come and lick his wounds. That was a continuous thing. This scene unfolded every day, and apparently it never changed. The rich man always ate. The poor man always sat there hoping he could eat, even a crust of bread, being compared to the drop of cool water that the rich man wanted Lazarus to drop on him. And the dogs would just, this thing played over and over and over again. What will stop this drama from happening? This rich man and Lazarus. Does it not still happen in our day? Huh? The rich man and Lazarus. You see it unfold all the time. I've been fascinated to see. There are a bunch of students from Florida A&M. Florida A&M is a historic black college university in Florida. The students there, and I'm sure with the help of some of the administration, campaigning against to the authorities of Florida to give them equal payment to the other colleges of Florida that aren't historical black college and universities. Because for years, unequal payment has been given. Rich man Lazarus. I was interested in the story of rats in Baltimore. Oh, we like to equate Baltimore and rats, don't we? We really do. There's a bumper sticker that says Baltimore to rat on it. I hate that. I'm from Baltimore. We're better than that. And the first story you hear is, oh, we found a dead rat and lying dead for 2 years in this health clinic in Druid Park, right? Druid Ridge, Druid something. Anyway, say it. And da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And a big deal being made about that and talking about in the paper this morning, well, you know, if Mayor, what's his name, Schaefer, were around, he'd have got rid of that rat a long time ago. And so forth and so on. But at the same time, there's this companion story about an apartment management company running 17 different apartment complexes that's having to pay an over $3 million fine, maybe more, because of their disreputable and deceptive treatment of the peer persons, the tens of thousands of people who live there, telling them that we have this really nice apartment and you can buy yourself rent into it if you agree to this long-term lease, and people do because it looks wonderful, and then putting them into a rat-infested apartment where no working air conditioning and dripping plumbing. Who are the rats in Baltimore, right? Who are the rats? Rich man and Lazarus. I could go on because the stories are endless. The stories are endless. The rich man and Lazarus gets played out all the time. The verbs are all continual. Until what happens? What happens to stop the continuity? Do you remember in the story?
Huh? They die.
They die. Yeah. Here's what's going to end this thing. They're going to die. And then, boom, God steps in. And God helps Lazarus, right? And Lazarus goes where? Rock my soul in the bosom of Abraham, rock my soul. Into rest and happiness is what that represents. And the rich man goes where?
Hades.
Yeah, the place of death, right? And for him, the place of torment. So, what do you do if you're a rich man in a place of torment? What do? I protest. I'm much better than this. I certainly shouldn't be here because, after all, everybody knows that blessings, richness is a sign of blessings of God. Guess what? Not. Right? Any assumption that wealth is an indication that God loves you and has made you wealthy is totally mistaken. The fate of this rich man, representing that group of people who are rich, and has gotten not a blessing, but a
curse.
However, the rich man can't really see it that way. He says, well, wait a minute. Good old buddy Abraham, father Abraham, do something about this. And notice how he totally misses the point. What's the point? Rich man, you're supposed to be providing hospitality for the person at your gate. Rich man, you're supposed to represent that your wealth doesn't remove you from the family of human beings. You're supposed to be a part of that family and make yourself a part of that family by contributing to the needs of others. Not just haphazardly, but the scriptures say generously. That's the fight of faith. The fight of faith is to be righteous. Righteousness is to provide hospitality to all others, using whatever resources we have for the good of others that don't have those resources. It happened that way from the beginning of the gospel. When someone asked, what shall we do? And the answer is, you've got two coats, give one to somebody who doesn't have any. If you've got a half a dozen pair of shoes, at least give two pairs of those shoes to somebody else. By the way, we did really good with our shoe collection. You know, we did a shoe collection here to help out the church in Violetville. And we collected a lot of shoes. Matter of fact, I took them over to Violetville yesterday and had this big container there to receive shoes. We filled it up. And I still got some in my car that I couldn't put in there. And so I'll get some more shoes and we'll fill it up again. Ah, where am I? Oh, yeah, and if you had two coats, give one to somebody who doesn't have any. And this rich man, whom I sure thought himself blessed from the Lord, refused to follow the commands of the Lord, and now finds himself in torment, but still does not recognize what he has done wrong by not seeing Lazarus as a part of the family. He's right there. He's in your house. He's at your gate. He's a part of your family. God is showing him to you. But what does he say about Lazarus now? Make him my servant, as he's supposed to be. Tell him to get some water and drop it down here on my head or right tongue or whatever you drop water on in this case and make me feel better. That man exists to make me feel better. That's all he's for. Rich man, you're so wrong. You're so wrong. And then his next plea is what? You remember?
Send somebody.
Huh?
Send somebody.
Yeah. Tell him to go to my father's house. I got five brothers. And you would think what he would say was, help them to understand that they really ought to show hospitality to the folks around so that everybody can eat, well, maybe not as well as they do, but at least well enough to survive. And I have dogs lick their sores. But that's not what he says, is it? That's not what he wants. Tell my brothers they should shape up or they're going to end in torment here. All he's concerned about is his brothers. He hadn't learned a thing about hospitality for the millions of poor people that are around him while he eats opulently. Succulently? How do you eat? Luxuriously. Right? At a five-star restaurant all the time. And he missed it. This is the whole point. And then Abraham reminds him, I've already told you all this. Everybody knows this is what you're supposed to do. Why don't you just do it? And then he said those fateful words, the ones at the end. Well, maybe if you would send somebody who came back from the dead, they would listen to him. Now it's Abraham that's saying this, right? Abraham, rich of the Old Testament faith. Abraham, the initial patriarch who kind of symbolizes the whole act of faith together, says, no, I don't think people listen, even if one comes back from the dead. It's a really sad ending. I think the only thing that would make it not a sad ending is what? Is if we and anybody else who hears the message that comes from the one who is risen from the dead responds and wholeheartedly gives themselves to this life of hospitality, this life of recognizing a sharing as an essential part of the community of human beings, of the family of humanity of which we are a part. This would respond positively to that, would turn and change the direction of the whole parable. So that at the end it would say, well, even if someone comes back from the dead, they won't listen to them, except there are some who do, and their names are, and you can name us, as witnesses to the life. Timothy said, that's the object of our faith, to make a witness to our life. Remember he said, as Jesus made his witness to Pontius Pilate, what was his witness to Pontius Pilate? He hardly didn't say anything, but he showed Pontius Pilate love is sacrificial for the sake of others and went and died on the cross for our sakes so that he could return from the dead and warn us that we have a great life in God if we would follow in his way. And we who pick up that warning raise our hands to make our witness, to say, no, this parable doesn't have a sad ending. This parable has a powerful ending. Because one has returned from the dead, and we know it, and his name is Jesus, and he shows us the way, and we'll follow it every day of our lives. We'll be unhappy. We will mourn the condition of our world that accommodates this continuous portrayal of rich man and Lazarus. And we will do whatever we can to fill in that horrible gap of income, of wealth, that exists between the rich man and Lazarus. And we will know And as sure as Lazarus wound up in the bosom of Abraham, so that too is our destiny. If we don't mess it up by refusing to live a life of hospitality and of being a giving part of the family of humanity God created. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, let stories ring in our hearts. Let images live in our lives. Let us see what a wonderful world Jesus sees. If only the rich man would share with Lazarus. Guide us and lead us. Warn us every day. And show us the truth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Our affirmation of faith will be taken from the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Time of talking about our giving to the Lord, our offering. We are aware that for a variety of different reasons, the weekly offerings of our congregation have fallen off in recent times. And there are reasonable explanations for that. But I am convinced that we will do all that we can to pick up in our offerings to sustain the life of this congregation. At the same time, however, I think it is equally noticeable that our offerings for others are increasing. We continue to send donations to UMCOR for relief for Ukrainian refugees and those suffering flood conditions in Pakistan. And we made a marvelous collection of canned goods. How many carloads did you have, Mary?
Two.
We filled Mary's car up twice with canned goods. And how did they go? They all gone?
Oh, no. But they were separated and shelved, and it's in supply, stock for next week.
Okay.
For Tuesday.
And so there'll be a more continuous supply of canned goods. We are good at that, and we are good at that, and we thank God for the ability to do that. And for knowing that with each of them comes the Lord's Spirit to enrich and hasten the day when all hunger is gone and every place is a safe place to live. Let us give thanks to God as we sing our doxology. Sunday before, but maybe you can't sing it enough. For one, it's a favorite hymn, and for the other, it's got the basic words that we need. Trust and obey, for there's no other way. But the wonder is knowing that with that trusting and obey, blessing flows. Blessing flows. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make God's face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon us. Give us his peace. Give us his joy.